Welcome to Fridays with Anne. This is a series of conversations with Belgian homeopath Anne Verfake about homeopathy. I will ask her curiously whatever confuses me in homeopathy, like case taking, case analysis, or theory in general. And Anne will answer according to her insights, experience, and most recent findings. You, the viewer, are invited to participate actively, so please feel free to send in comments and questions. For more information on Anne and her work, please follow these links, which will also be posted below every video. And now today's episode of Fridays with Anne.
Hello, it's Friday again, and I'm here with Anne Verwarke. Hello, Anne. Good morning.
Good morning, Joost.
Good to see you. The last shows were covered with topics of philosophy and of case management. So this time I thought we go back to some more knowledge of materia medica, and I wanted to maybe over the next couple of episodes look at with you at some groups of remedies, and particularly groups that are not so present in our minds of as homeopaths. We normally tend to look at plants, elements, and animals, and arguably these might be the most represented remedies, but maybe not. Anyway, the kingdom that I wanted, or the group, the family that I wanted to look at today with you is the group of bacteria, or monera, as they were termed before. So, or in other words, maybe you can give me your idea of what belongs into this group of simple beings.
Okay, that's a very good idea, because yes, I think we should get something practical. We did enough of philosophy, and the group you mentioned is very often overlooked, because people somehow, homeopaths somehow, don't have the idea this can be a vital remedy, this can be a sensation, you know, a bacteria or a nozzle we only use as an intercurrent remedy or to take away some miasmatic loads or something. That's the way we use nozzles, or when we separate and the case doesn't want to, you know, take off, let's try a nozzle.
Yeah.
You know how it goes. And we think about plants or animals as the big groups, and elements as if in the second dimension, and we talked about second dimension cases and third dimension cases, as if in the second dimension they're only elements. And I think we pointed to that there are other groups that are either not known or overlooked, like the germ plants, for instance, they're hardly ever used, although they should. And another group is the nozzles, is the bacteria and viruses. I would still put in one group, although they have differences among them. But I think this is quite common. I do see them quite often. Again, it's possible because I have like a selection of patients. That means that patients who went to other homeopaths and didn't get the traditional remedy might give a try on me. And so maybe more than average, I see constitutional nozzle cases of monera, bacteria, people who need constitutionally a bacterium as their vital remedy.
Yeah, that's a good point that I kind of skipped, but we should come back to this before we go into the aspects of this kingdom. You mentioned that before we would consider the miasmatic remedies, right? It was an intercurrent, and we maybe a remedy wasn't working well, or we had relapses, so we had to give one of the classical nozzles, Sorinum or Medorinum, and have barely ever considered it a vital remedy, a remedy that can act as the remedy for the patient, right? You're back.
Yeah, you disappear. So you will have to like repeat your last sentence. In the middle of your sentence, you will disappear.
Yeah, that is fine.
Okay.
No problem. I just try to connect back to where I was.
You said we use them as nosal intercurrents, so you know.
Exactly. We use them as miasmatic remedies in the past, rather than considering them a constitutional remedy for the patient. And this is very interesting that you have several of these cases now confirming that they can act as the main remedy for the patient and not only a remedy to remove a block or something like this.
Because we tend to prescribe when we feel we have a second dimension case in front of us, we tend to prescribe minerals. And the second dimension, we talked about it, is when patients are a little bit aloof, you know, their cases seems to be more simple, like it's more straightforward, there's one issue, we can boil it down to one issue, and we try to fit it somewhere on the periodic table. But we don't know quite where, doesn't quite fit, we try to work, they talked about work, because everybody does, and family, everybody has a family, but it doesn't really fit. And actually, it doesn't at all, because the patient is talking about a completely different thing. The whole issue is about being sick, by being diseased, by being not normal. And all the things that the patient did and tried and is still doing in order to get better. And the patient will talk about it in length. The whole consultation will be filled with that, no matter how hard you try to get the patient deeper, because as sensation prescribers, we want the patient to go deep in himself and find the sensation, and he's annoying you because he's talking and you can't make them go off this topic of disease symptoms, and you feel it's superficial, it's fact level, you cannot make a decent prescription with a patient who is so unwilling to go deeper or incapable to go deeper, and what he shows you in front of you, that's the whole case. That is the issue. That is the patient's vital sensation. And it's a vital prescription. I'm sick. I'm diseased. I'm not normal. I'm weak. And I want to be healthy. That's it. That's the patient needing a bacteria.
Yeah. And that's also, I mean, some... in these cases where you want to fit it somewhere on the table, then it seems like it's a simple, rather simple concern they have, so to say, but it doesn't really sit well with otherwise clear second row, third row. Yeah. But it is of this second dimension. So you already... a few characteristics. What would you say? How can we spot now? Okay, this is second dimension, obviously, but it's a meant case. So, what are good pointers for identifying those cases?
Yes, we need those, and the pointers are reliable and confirmed by many, many cases I've seen. So you can really discern them in your patient. The most important thing is, and we repeated it often, do not lead your consultation. Because if you're looking at your part, looking for a deep word, and the patient says, for instance, I'm anxious about this disease, and you say, talk me about anxious. Yeah? And how does it feel to be anxious? Mm-hmm. How is it for you to be anxious? You know, then you lead the patient into the anxiety, hoping that will be the way to deeper things. While the patient only wants to talk about his blocked nose or his achy muscles or whatever, you know, if you lead him away from what he wants to tell you, you will miss the case. So that's a general remark, but it's very important in those sort of cases because of our frustration. We get so frustrated because it doesn't seem to get us anywhere else than the disease symptoms. And that's exactly what the patient is trying to convey to you. So that's the first thing. They will talk about all their disease symptoms, not necessarily serious for you, but for the patient, that's their life. Most of the time, the disease symptoms will have either many diagnoses or no diagnosis at all. But usually, they have many. None of them fits. That's also something you have to keep in mind. They went to several doctors and everybody put the label on it, and no label really fits. So that should make you a little bit suspicious. They have chronic fatigue, they have fibromyalgia, they have a leaky gut, they have a whatnot. All these second level problems, the energy level problems, you know, functional problems most of the time, but crippling. I mean, the patient is feeling bad all of the time, day in and day out, and they have like 25 symptoms, and all of them are disabling them, even if they have only one symptom, and the, and whatever he talks about, it always comes down to this one symptom. It's about my health is not good, I'm trying to get healthy, I feel sick, I feel weak, I try to become strong, it's not normal that I have this, because with a little effort I have symptoms, with a little change of diet I have symptoms, and all other people, they don't have symptoms, they can live their normal life, and I can't. So normal and abnormal, weak and strong, sick and healthy will be the red thread throughout the case.
Okay. The extremes between which the patient goes back and forth. Okay. It sounds like they are not too emotional either.
No, not overly. You're right, they're not overly emotional. It's more you feel like they're comparing, and you might get confused because you think, oh, they're comparing, there must be animal. But then there's no other animal energy or characteristic in case whatsoever. Because, for instance, like this lack of emotionality or intensity. But they will say, like, everybody can, you know, walk 10 kilometers and I cannot do even 5. That's not normal for my age, for instance. So they compare, but they compare their health with the normal standard. Not, I want to be better than the other one. I want to walk 25 kilometers if everybody can walk 20. That would be animal thing. And also, since they're talking about weak and strong, we might think of a mineral, but for them the strength is vitality. It's to have enough vitality in order to live, nothing more than that. And the normal might also make you think of a fourth row mineral, or they talk about normal, they want the normal,
right
yeah, that's confusing.
Or security or health,
absolutely. For them it's like, I want to be like everybody else, but not in having a possibility to sustain myself, because mostly they can. It's not an issue, they just do. They sustain themselves, so they won't talk about it. If they have a crippling health issue, they might be afraid they lose their job, which is all. That is facts. If you're sick half of the year, you might lose your job in the end. So the worry is in proportion to the, let's say, the threat. But their normal life is having normal vitality, having a normal body, having a normal energy for my age. So the normal is not about being a good citizen with a house, with a partner, with children, with a pension, with 3 holidays a year. That's not the normal they're talking about. It's normal health average, like all the others.
Would you say that it's that can be easily confused with a, if you, we think of kali or calcium or arsenicum, who seem to be very, or can be very concerned about their health also, and if that is focusing around it.
Yeah, it can be confused if the homeopath tries to squeeze the patient in, like a K-line or a calcium or an arsenicum or whatever, fourth row patients mostly will be very anxious about their health. But the anxiety is because they are afraid to lose their stability, their security, and that's what they need in order to live. While the Monora patient will show you somehow, funnily enough, somehow this optimistic stamina to keep trying to get better. It's not so much anxiety that's driving them, it is the determination in which they try and try and try to find the right diet, because they will be very occupied with diet. They're simple creatures, so so eating and sleeping and growing is very important. They're central issues in their life. So they will talk about diet, but a lot of patients do, so that's confusing. But the Monora, trying all kinds of diets in order to find the right one for them, in order to feel better, will be a big issue. Trying to find the right therapy, the right doctor, the right supplement, whatever. They keep doing treatment after treatment and spa after spa, and you know, their mind is completely occupied to get better, while the fourth row minerals, they have anxiety. If I lose my health, I might lose everything. I won't be able to sustain myself. I can't go to work. I end in the gutter. That's what they will say. I will lose everything. So that's a different fear behind the anxiety about health.
Okay, so when you know, or when we say bacteria, Monora, what do we actually incorporate into this group?
I would say the bacteria and the viruses, though they have distinct characteristics and a few more, let's say, mind characteristics of the bacteria, because they both will talk about health and disease, and they will have this very funny non-existing chronic states of acute diseases, which is very strange and will help you to find the right bacterium. So for instance, let's say measles, right? Measles is an acute disease. You can have a patient who has chronic measles symptoms. They don't exist in reality, because homeopathy is only as if, we know that. So they will display these symptoms, or they will have like a chronic, what can I say? A chronic, let's say, pest, when you need a pest nozzle. There's no chronic, but your patient might display those symptoms, which is very strange. I have like a Brucella case. Brucellosis is an acute disease. But this patient was diseased for over 10 years, having this non-existing chronic Brucella state. Strange, isn't it? So that's also a pointer to bacteria. Or viruses the same. I had a patient that, you know, had a chronic-like influenza. We don't have chronic influenza. But a young girl for years was in muscle pain and bone pain and you know, this snotty nose and not feeling well and no energy. Like as if somebody on the verge of getting a serious influenza. But she didn't have influenza. She didn't have influenza for the past 2 years, but as if, as if. So also this diagnosis.
Normal state.
Yeah, it's very strange. It's a state. It's you know, on vital level. So of course it's chronic, but they refer.
And also physical.
Absolutely.
Do they also physically? Yeah.
Yeah, it's the physical I'm talking about. The mental picture of a bacterium is also very, outlined. But it's confusing in the beginning, because as I told you, they're simple organisms, So they have like, see, I'm not talking about IQ, you know, intelligence has
not. The patient, no, the patient is not a simple organism. No.
The patient can be intelligent, highly intelligent and highly functioning, but his basic issues go back to, as I told you, kind of primitive interest in food, sleep, eat, grow well, growing, grow better. And his mindset, that is a bit subtle, depending on the environment, he can talk about everything, but you feel confused, but somehow it doesn't make sense. So we have a lot of patients that in the beginning we think, what the hell are they talking about? But usually in the course of the interview, the picture becomes clearer and clearer and clearer. We ask for details, the patient explains, and he repeats with more details and more words, and we get it clear. Now with the monorail, with the bacteria, it will never get clear unless you make an unclear case clear. But that is what the homeopath does. It's not what the patient is. And this, it is unclear, I mean, they say things that people say. And then they say another thing that somebody said, which might be contradictory, contradicting the first statement. And when you ask yourself, what he said black and he said white, like three sentences later, and you want to ask, in a very gentle and polite way, of course. You don't say, wait a minute, you contradict yourself. You just say, you said this and also that. So can you explain me a little bit how? And then they will give you another explanation which doesn't make sense at all. So it won't clarify, it will confuse even more. And then the homeopath will try to make something of this confusion. By doing this, you miss the case. The observation is, and that's context, whatever the patient tells, it is not a coherent, logical explanation of a point of view that you can pin him down to. In the end, you will ask yourself, what does he stand for? What is his idea? And you won't get an answer.
Yeah. So that sounds, I was going to say, that sounds like also information about how the case presents itself to us.
Yes.
Context information, but it sounds also very difficult then for us to spot these cases. I mean, if we take into consideration this confusing aspect and this contradictory aspect and also the polarities of health diseased or health ill and weak, strong, and normal, abnormal, then we might end up at the kingdom, at least. That's already a big step.
Yes.
What can you say then from your experience? How can we further narrow down the substances that come into question for the particular case?
Of course, because we still have a lot of choice then.
If we well, I mean, we don't have to prescribe from 2 million remedies. I'm sure, but
I don't know exactly how many bacteria there are. As I said before, usually we don't want to know how many possibilities there are, but not the millions. You're right. What can help? So if you know I need a bacteria, what kind of bacteria should I need? Well, of course, you have the disease symptoms. At least that is a clear pointer. What kind of symptoms the patient displays? But it can be also confusing because, for instance, that there might be a disease, let's say, producing cough, and the patient doesn't have a cough. That's a bit of a problem. So sometimes our repertory will help us out, that we will repertorize particular symptoms. Let's say the patient has a wrist problem or joint problems, and I do have some patients. And then you repertorize, and then of course you have to select only bacteria. Sorry. So you can come up with some surprising outcomes, because again, thank God, we have provings of these bacteria, not of all of them, but we do have provings, and so they might show up in your repertorization of a bacteria you wouldn't have thought of, because of the disease is known for this particular symptom, yet the patient has like a side symptom, let's say a concomitant, something like that. Mm-hmm. It doesn't need to have, in a chronic way, the main symptom of the disease. For instance, we had a patient with, what was it again? Botulinum. Botulinum. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think she's somewhere in the book she's published. So this patient didn't have diarrhea. And you, that's at least something you would expect in an acute phase of a bacterial infection. You would expect with a lot of people, high fever, vomiting, diarrhea, etc. But you have like concomitant symptoms, and the patient had troubles with intestines in a chronic way, although she didn't have chronic diarrhea. But one of her symptoms was that she has this heaviness in her arms, this extreme heaviness in her arms. And this is a symptom of the proving of this remedy. And it was so specific and so inexplicable. And of course, lacking in all the diagnosis she got before, because the doctor doesn't know what to do with it. So that's also how you know the diagnosis doesn't fit. The patient suffers from this symptom a lot, and it's not covered by the label, so you know it must be outside of the label. But no doctor with a sane mind would think of this particular infection, because it's a chronic state. So he can only see the acute flare up of this disease. And we are sometimes helped by the concomitant, like the symptoms, they are also showing up, and especially the provings with this particular bacteria. That's one, provings, and of course symptoms of the patient, and in the history. So you always ask, did you have any serious disease in the past, or did you have an episode? And very often then you'll hear like, oh yeah, I had the measles, I was horribly sick, you know, like I was in the hospital for 2 weeks, and then you know that's not normal.
Yeah,
that's a susceptibility that the patient has. Uh-huh. And I was once able to prescribe morbillinum just because the patient was in her 50s, you know, and ailing all of her life, and only after, I don't know, the 10th consultation or something, she talked about this phase of her very, very extremely bad episode of measles. And then I understood that the issues were actually like chronic measles. Very strange for 40
people. Okay. Yeah. All right. That's very interesting. Interesting and unusual. So we could expect an unusual physical symptomatology, something that doesn't fit with what we know from the books of diseases, and also something that doesn't fit with the diagnosis of the patient.
And it can be, I would just want to add this, it can be something like extreme vertigo, like I said, vomiting and diarrhea is in a lot, and fever in a lot of acute. But for instance, one bacteria might produce this extreme vertigo. That could be a pointer, and the patient might have chronic vertigo. And the other might produce, as I told you, pain in the wrists, which is not very visible in the acute, might not even be there, but it might be a chronic state. So. Yeah. As I told you, the measles patient didn't have spots in her skin. She didn't have any skin problem at all. But she had the throat pain and the weakness and the low blood pressure and whatnot.
Yeah. Okay. Right. Right. So we have these pointers to arrive at particular remedies to narrow it down. So we can say that the bacteria belong to it. So consider our nozzles, because they are not always bacteria as such, right?
Mm-hmm. No.
For example, Metalrhinum is not a bacterium, is not a called gonorrhea bacteria, but it's made of the pus, so it's. But it, you would still consider it part of this kingdom, right?
Yes, you know, we talked about this before. Homeopathy is mainly symbolic. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So if you say Midrinum is made of the pus, you're right. Sorinum, same thing. It's made of. Sorinum should be a parasite. Actually, it's an insect.
Yeah. There is not even a bacteria.
It's not even a bacteria, and then it causes this little infections in your under your skin, and then you have this fluid, and then from this fluid is made the remedy. Oh, God knows what the remedy is made of. Part of the insect, yeah. Part of your skin, part of this fluid. What is it? Yeah. And we say, oh, it's scabies.
Yeah.
So we. How to say, we give it a meaning, a more or less symbolic meaning, and it represents this particular idea. So yes, Midrinum represents a particular idea of psychosis. Yeah, that's the heart of psychosis. But also you have the bacterium that causes gonorrhea. And then it would maybe present itself more like bacterium. So it can have like two faces, and you can still use the nozzles, let's say the classical nozzles, in a miasmatic way. Why not?
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes. And the idea of the miasm is the main inflammation you get. That's another kind of case. Then it's where the patient presents with, like, I have to hide, I have to deny, I live with it, and that's your case. Or I have to control, I have to control, I have to control. Otherwise, things will go haywire, and that's fatal. And it's carcinosin. If that is your case, and nothing else, or nothing else you can see for the time being.
Okay. Right. Good. So I would sum up what we spoke about today with little interruptions caused by some viruses, obviously.
Probably.
We spoke about the kingdom of Monera bacteria, and that they can also be vital remedies, just as all the other remedies that we have at our disposal in homeopathy. How to identify cases from this kingdom, and that they also are part of the second dimension, so they might be most easily confused with. Yes, and ways how to narrow down the selection of the particular remedy once we have figured out that we have a one of such cases in front of us. Right. I might come back to this topic also speaking about the remedies, because they seem to have a slightly special position.
Yes, they do. They're different.
Yeah. We will speak about more groups anyway, so we will fit this into one of the following episodes.
Okay.
Thank you for this one, Anne. I look forward to speaking to you next time.
Okay, me too.
Have a good time.
You too. Bye.
Bye-bye.